Hello everyone, this is Madhusudan Raj, your host. Welcome back to my economic reports. We are meeting after 3 months' time, almost 3 months' time, since I last updated you about the demonetization. Today is 5th February 2019. This is a new year, and this is the year of election for the Indians. So the Narendra Modi government is finishing 5 years, has finished 5 years of its power. Narendra Modi came with a thumping majority victory to power in 2014. And I am here in front of you today to recap the 5 years of Narendra Modi's prime ministership. So I want to just very briefly discuss about the major economic policy decisions and its impact on the Indian economy by the Narendra Modi government. What happened in this last 5 years? So this is like account of Narendra Modi government's 5 years in power. We don't know what is going to happen in 2019 when Modi goes for re-election bid. Many polls are now saying that the charisma and the aura and the power that Narendra Modi once had. He was almost invincible. Now that invincibility is no longer there. That we saw in the local elections, where the Modi's BJP party lost 3 states to opposition party Congress, Madhya Pradesh, Rajasthan and Jharkhand. Many of the polls are also showing that Narendra Modi government will not get majority, that magic number of 272, and they will fall short of the majority mark. That means there will be horse trading and buying and selling of MPs will go on. Many people are now saying that inside BJP there is a lot of discontent against the Modi and Shah duo, because these people are ruling with a lot of authoritarian dictatorial power. They are not listening to their own. RSS has also kind of turned against Narendra Modi because he has promised to build a Ram temple in Ayodhya, but nothing is happening on that front also. Anyway, keeping aside the politics of India today, I want to focus on the performance of Narendra Modi government in last 5 years. So I want to start with the first 2 years of Modi government. He came to power in May 2014. And almost for 1.5 years, nothing really happened. Nothing much really happened. Remember, he came on the, he won the election on the platform of bringing back the black money from the Swiss governments and making India kind of, a business-friendly country. So many people, when he came to power at that time, many people were saying that Narendra Modi is a, a free market-friendly prime minister and he's right-wing prime minister, etc., etc. So for the first 1.5-2 years, nothing actually happened, and then people started doubting his abilities. And to prove people wrong, and to show that he's and to continue and keep his image that he very craftily built through marketing policies, his image of a macho man, his image of a strong prime minister, his image of a 56-inch. Just prime minister, is a very powerful prime minister. He decided on 8th November 2016 to, he came on national television 8 p.m. in the evening and suddenly announced that 86% of total currency notes of 500,000 rupees will no longer remain legal tender. So he declared overnight that all this 86% of total money supply in India will be just piece of paper. So at that time, as I have discussed many times in my past analysis also, I don't want to go back to those things again and again. I told you that this policy will be a disastrous policy for the economy. At that time, they had many of the stated goals. They no longer were fulfilled, like combating the black money or fighting the terrorism or fighting the millions of fake notes. All those things are today with us, with vengeance. So demonetization really, jolted the whole Indian economy, especially the backbone of the Indian economy, unorganized sector, what they call the underground economy. Because remember, in India, the organized sector is only around 13%. 87% of the 87-90% of the economy is unorganized. It's not on the paper. So instead of bringing back the black money from the Swiss government, now nobody's talking about that. You know, Modi also promised everybody that they'll get 15 lakh rupees in, you know, each Indian's account, around 1.5 million rupees in each Indian's account, but no money has yet been credited into anybody's account. So instead of bringing back that money from the Swiss bank, Narendra Modi started attacking the hardworking, honest taxpayers of India itself. You know, the income tax department started harassing everybody. Anyway, so demonetization was that was a failure immediately. So they changed the rules for so many times. And then later on, they say that no, this is not, this has nothing to do with black money or whatever. This has to do everything with making India a cashless country, digital country. Anyway, so that continued, and that really created a lot of problem for the labor market. As I said, it broke the back of the unorganized sector, which is providing majority of the employment and, you know, GDP share in the economy. Around 50% of Indian economy, more than 50% economy is underground economy. So more than 50% of the production is coming from this so-called underground black market economy. So that was, demonetization was a direct attack on that sector. And one result was very much expected at very that time, that unemployment will soar. So not only demonetization, but after that, one disastrous policy, there was another disaster policy of goods and service tax. So after demonetization, in few months time, Narendra Modi rolled back, forward the one nation, one tax policy of goods and service tax. So that tax was claimed as a one nation, one tax, but there was nothing like that. We know that now that it's been almost 2 years of implementation of GST, and situation is pretty bad in the market. I come from the city of Surat, which is a textile and diamond hub of Gujarat, and 50% of the businesses are finished in Surat right now. And a team of Delhi is also going to conduct some kind of surveys. You know, I just today morning read that what impact it has. Impact is this, that it has devastated the labor market. It has devastated the businesses in Surat city, not just Surat city, all across country. So GST was a disastrous implementation. Nobody knows what is going on. You know, people have to file so many returns, you know, three returns in a month's time, and a problem of e-way bill and don't know what. So the major impact of these two policies is now, you know, is being now confirmed by the studies which are done by government's own National Sample Survey Organization, as well as the independent, you know, kind of research organizations like the Center for Monitoring Indian Economy, CMIE. So a few days back, CMIE published its report that after the implementation of demonetization and GST policy, Indian economy lost in 2017-18, it lost around 11 million jobs, that is 1.1 crore jobs. So Narendra Modi announced that he's going to give employment to around 4 crore people instead of providing jobs to these 4 crore people. 1.1 crore people lost job just because of demonetization and GST in 1 year period. And when Narendra Modi was asked that what is his solution for the problem of unemployment by a ZTV anchor, remember, Narendra Modi has not given a single open press, you know, reporting press conference in his whole of these 5 years. So we don't know. Basically, he doesn't want to come in front of the probing questions coming from the reporters. So he has not given the press conference. What he's doing is he's just, you know, making his monkey bath instead of listening to the monkey bath of 1.3 billion Indians. But anyway, so the CMI report has now said that Indian economy had a big problem. You remember that the GDP growth rate also came down very heavily to 5%. It lost around 2% from the GDP also immediately after the implementation of these policies. Not only that, recently the leaked data from NSS, or the National Sample Survey Organization, which conducts, which comes under Central Statistical, you know, Office, CSO, They also conducted the employment and unemployment survey in India, like what they do every 5 years. the rounds. So in that report also, there was a very grim picture coming of the Indian labor market, and Narendra Modi government was not allowing this report to get published. And to protest that, recently two of the members of that statistical commission, they have resigned. Two of the statisticians have resigned, saying that the government is sitting on this report even after the green signal given, even after the green signal given by the commission. It was signed by the commission and it was ready to publish. The government is not publishing. So now the Niti Aayog people like Rajiv Kumar and Vivek Debaroy, they are coming out and saying that, well, there was an anomaly, the methodology of conduct, kind of gathering this data were different. So now they're doing politics over these numbers. But we know from the ground reality that the situation of unemployment is pretty bad. This leak report from NSSO says that the unemployment in India is now highest of last 45 years. It has never been this high. The unemployment has never been this high in India since 1971-72. So they are pegging it around 6.1%, and for all this 45 years it was around 2%. That's what they're saying, and these data are also not believable. But anyway, right? So that has gone up like anything. So this is very embarrassing for the Modi government going into the re-election bid this year. So they are not lying. Now they are saying that they are going to conduct another survey, and obviously we know what is going to happen to that. They are massaging data. Recently, they revised the GDP numbers also upward by around 110 basis points. So they are trying every bit hard to show as if everything is hunky-dory with the Indian economy. But we know that everything is not hunky-dory. The perception is being created in the foreign media also around the world that as if India is an emerging market economy. But those who are in India and those who are seeing the ground reality, they know that these things are not true. Economy is really struggling very hard right now, right? Stock market has not gone anywhere. It has been moving in between 32,000 and 38,000 since last 5 years. It has not breached, like many people were saying, when Modi will come to power, stock market will zoom to 70,000 and 1 lakh point. Nothing like that has happened. It is just hovering in between that range of 32,000 and 38,000, 39,000. Rupee has depreciated a lot, right? It went to around 40, 74 rupees per dollar. The petrol price also touched around 100 rupees per liter, even when the international prices are not very high. International prices are just around $75 per barrel. It has come down to significantly to $50 per barrel, but still the prices in India are not budging because the Modi government is imposing very heavy excise duty on petrol and diesel items and pocketing huge amounts of money. So not only that, after that, we also know that one after another, intellectuals are resigning from the Narendra Modi government on economic front. This is also very important to understand. So the first person to resign was the vice chairman of Niti Aayog, Mr. Arvind Panagariya. Now remember that Arvind Panagariya is a colleague of Professor Jagdish Bhagwati, who is a Columbia professor. And before the election, everybody was saying that Narendra Modi follows Jagdish Bhagwati's development model. Like Gujarat follows the Bhagwati model and rest of the country, Congress is following the Amartya Sen, the Sen model, socialist model. So this colleague of Jagdish Bhagwati, he also resigned from the Narendra Modi government. And after resigning, he penned a very important critical article about Narendra Modi's policies. We know that world over, protectionism is rising now, nationalism is rising its head. Everywhere, country, nation states are saying that they are first. Like in America, Donald Trump is saying America first. In France, Macron is saying France first. In India, Narendra Modi started making India, like India first. After 3-4 years, making India is nowhere. Swachh Bharat Abhiyan is nowhere. All these programs are gone already. Nobody remembers them anymore. But anyway, so because of this rising protectionism, Modi government is imposing heavy tariff duty on many of the items that are coming from foreign countries. They're trying to stifle the competition to benefit some of the industrialists in India. For example, they have imposed very heavy import duty on steel items. And steel is majority produced by the likes of, Birlas and Tatas and everyone. So to protect these multi-billionaires, government is imposing duty on steel and other items. Not only that, kites, rockies, LCDs, refrigerator, electronic items. Import duties have gone up like anything. So Arvind Panagariya could not take it because, you know, they believe that free foreign trade is very important for the progress of the economy, which is correct. So Panagariya resigned first. After that was to go, before that, Raghuram Rajan, the RBI, you know, governor, was shown doorway by Modi government. They did not renew his term and he resigned in agony. Now we know that why he resigned, because he was against demonetization. They asked him and he said no, of course. And he was also trying to fix the NPA problem, the non-performing asset problem. We know that the banks in India, they have accumulated a lot of debt, and that is creating a lot of problem for the country, because these banks are all bankrupt and insolvent. So Raghuram Rajan was trying to clean the account books of the banks by, you know, making the lending norms tight and asking the banks to first clean their books and then restart again. So Modi did not like that and he removed him. So first one to go was Raghuram Rajan. Second was to go was Arvind Panagariya. Then Urjit Patel also recently resigned because, you know, we know that there was a big tussle going on between RBI and the government. So Narendra Modi government is also busy attacking one institution after another. They attacked the Reserve Bank of India first. You know, Reserve Bank of India was kind of supposedly known to be an autonomous institution, which is not correct. Reserve Bank of India is wholly owned by the Indian government. So Modi government, because the economy is not doing well, unemployment is very high. So Narendra Modi government, they want to spend a lot of money, because the only way they know how to kind of kickstart the economy, and which is not the right way to kickstart the economy. But anyway, so they only know to spend money, and for that they need money, and they don't have money because the taxation, they cannot tax people very much, because already the tax authorities are harassing everyone, even salaried people like me. You know, I received a couple of notices from income tax department, even though my taxes are already, you know, kind of deducted by my employer. So they are harassing innocent, honest taxpayers. So that they cannot do. So they don't have enough of the tax money. They cannot borrow from the market because the creditworthiness of the Indian government is pretty low. The bond rating is already, you know, just on the border of junk rating, which is B++. So nobody is going to borrow that much of money to the Indian government. So the only, you know, kind of venue now remains, the only tool now remains in the hand of Modi is printing, which is inflation. And that's the reason why they asked the RBI to reduce the interest rate when RBI started raising the rates, because inflation became a real problem. So they wanted them to, you know, stop in increasing the rate. They want them to reduce the rate and print, you know, currency. Not only that, they also want RBI to transfer the surplus, you know, money that they have around 7-8 lakh crore rupees to the, you know, government's account, so then they can spend money. So Urjit Patel, again, he was a professional economist. So although he was appointed by Narendra Modi, that means he was supposed to be loyal to Narendra Modi, but he must have said no. The deputy governor, Viral Acharya, he started all the, you know, he started opposing this move of government to attack the surplus reserve. So Urjit Patel also resigned. After that, Arvind Subramanian, who was the chief economic advisor of Narendra Modi, he also resigned. He went back to USA. Not only that, another member of the, you know, economic advisory team of Narendra Modi, Surjit Bhalla, he also resigned. So one after another, and now this statistical commission members, these two members, they have resigned. So all these resignations show that the people who know economics, they no longer trust Narendra Modi government, because he is, you know, creating protectionism. He's trying to protect the local businesses. Local businesses means some of the business tycoons. For example, this recent e-commerce policy, which is barring the likes of Amazon and Walmart, which just, you know, kind of took over Flipkart. It bars them from selling, you know, items from the company in which they have equity share, as well as they cannot stop the seller from selling item on multiple, you know, storefront. So because of that, Flipkart has to remove around 25% of their, you know, item that they are selling. Amazon has to readjust everything. There is a huge customer disruption. And all this supposedly to benefit one guy. You know that, Mukesh Ambani, because he has announced that he is going to enter into the e-commerce, e-retail, you know, business. So that's to clear his way and supposedly to, you know, make the level, you know, feel level playing. Modi is doing this, but anyway, this is going to hurt. This is already hurting the customers. It is already going to hurt. Going to create more unemployment. This kind of e-commerce policies. I am hearing that the Competition Commission is also going after the likes of Domino's. They are saying that you did not pass the benefit of GST to the customer. So they asked them to deposit 41 crore rupees to government instead of giving it to customers. So what is happening in India? And obviously the Modi government is breaking one kind of tradition after another. They are into the election year and they are not supposed to present the budget. They have to wait for the election to take place and then allow the next government to present the budget. But instead of that, Narendra Modi presented the interim budget last February, 1st February. And they announced all kind of bonanza into that, 6,000 rupees for every farmer and this subsidy and that subsidy and income tax, you know, kind of rebate. There was also break up to 5 lakh, you know, you don't have to kind of, there was rebate of full amount and everything. That they have left to the next government. But anyway, so this is going to, you know, kind of burden, the subsidy burden is going to become pretty huge now. And from where they're going to get all this money? They're just going to ask the RBI to print. That is the reason why they have put a career bureaucrat, a history guy who has no knowledge of economics as a governor of RBI, Saktikanta Das. So now everybody is saying that Saktikanta Das will reduce the interest rate and print currency, print rupees and give to Narendra Modi so he can spend and, you know, get into power once again. So, you know, kind of in the race of getting re-elected, this government is, you know, has just disregarded all the economic principles. They took one wrong decision after another wrong decision and they have devastated the economy. So, and I don't want to talk about the, you know, Rafael scam and everything, as I say. All kind of, you know, restrictions are there. Protectionism is rising in India, which is not a good thing, right? If you don't trade with other people, then you are going to remain poor. You have to understand that because trading is what makes us rich. We cannot produce everything on our own that we want to consume. So we have to get that from somebody else. That means trading. That means exchange. And if the government is not going to exchange with others locally as well as internationally, then India is going to remain poor. So all these policies that the Modi government is following is going to make sure, it's making sure that India will not become a superpower. Whatever, forget about superpower, India is becoming poor. You know that since 2014, around 23,000, 25,000 multi-millionaires have left India. So people are leaving India because of this crackdown, this is tax harassment and so-called crackdown on black money and everything. So when these productive people who are making money honestly, when they are leaving this country, who's going to produce wealth for this economy, right? All these populist policies of, you know, pleasing the farmers and pleasing the middle class and pleasing everyone who will vote for them is going to result into disaster. You know, politics is triumphing economics in India. And I don't think so. This is a problem of BJP or Narendra Modi. This is a problem of this country because people are like that. People want everything for free. And as long as people are going to demand things for free, politicians are going to be obliged to fulfill those promises because they have to win power. They want power because politicians only live and die for one and one thing, election and re-election. So they are going to do that. And this is what is going to devastate the country. As long as, you know, people are going to be in love with poverty and as long as poor people are having all sympathy and as long as rich people are demonized in this country, India cannot become rich because a country where making profit becomes a crime, like as I said, what happened with Domino's, in that country, nobody can do business. Now we are hearing that Walmart may, you know, come out of the, you know, takeover bid of Flipkart. They may no longer, you know, kind of go on with that takeover bid. So if Walmart is gone from India, if Amazon is gone from India, what are we going to do? I mean, employment will be gone, right? You know, are we supposed to, you know, kind of buy everything from Ambanis and Adanis and Tatas and Birlas? Anyway, so what I'm saying is the problem is not with the politician, the problem is with the people of this country. So as long as people will not understand all this thing, they will not take responsibility of their lives on their own shoulders, things are not going to improve. No matter who the next government is going to be, whether Rahul Gandhi or Mamata Banerjee or Mayawati, I'm sure they are going to continue this same policy. They already started waiving the, you know, subsidies and everything of the farmers, their debt. Who's going to pay for all these things, you know? Anyway, so I want to wrap up over here. So this 5 years of Narendra Modi government has been a disaster, and I think the disaster will continue. India is on a path from where it cannot come back, I guess. The next government, whoever makes it, is going to continue the same policies, and the result is going to be the same also. I don't think so. We are going to see any Achhe Din anymore in future. So you take care out there, and I'll come back and see you once again. When the election will be over, I will come back and present the analysis, whoever comes to power next. Until then, goodbye, and thank you for watching me.